Should be streaming. Right, so introduce ourselves. I'm Joshua Capel, and this is Director of First Year Jonathan Kress.
Hi. So we're here to give you some, I guess, go through the sample exam, maybe give you some tips on what we're expecting in the exam paper, because this year's exam paper is quite a bit different to previous years. The sample exam is on Moodle, so hopefully you've downloaded it. The front page looks like this. And we'll maybe just say a few words about the actual format of the exam and how it's going to go before we start.
Right. So there are going to be two question blocks. So it's question one and question two. The marks inside here, well, there are 5 marks for presentation. We'll talk about that in a second. And the other 15 marks for that question come from... are listed in the questions themselves.
So yeah, it shows you how many for each sub-question, yeah, and the 5 marks overall. So you've got, you'll have three booklets to use in the exam, so that's like this. One of them for rough working, and one for question one, and one for question two. If you run out of room, you can ask for another book, but we don't expect that you'll need to. The rough working is really meant to be where you put down, you know, sort of scribbles and test things out, but what we want in the end is a nicely sort of written out solution, because in this exam you've got quite a lot less to work on than typically in a 2-hour exam, and that means that we want you to actually write it well. So we're not going to mark what's in the rough book. You can put whatever you like there, but make sure you actually get to writing this stuff in good form in the real book.
Yeah, we shouldn't have to look at your rough working book to work out what happened in the question. That should what happens in your question one and question two books should explain what's going on completely. Yeah.
Okay, so we said there's 2 questions. Maybe we'll just say a little bit about the 5 marks. Essentially, those marks are for the presentation, and there's a few aspects to that. One of them is correct notation. You really must use notation correctly, and there's a whole range of different topics in this course, and each of them has their own notation, like augmented matrices and matrices.
Limits,
there's differential equations.
We also do some partial differential.
Partial derivatives, which have a different, you know, curly sort of D. There's recurrence relations, we have to use subscripts and things like that. So just make sure you get all that right. And there's also my perennial bugbear is that people who use equal sign when they don't mean equals. Equals should actually say that the thing on the left and the right is the same. And sometimes you might just mean approximately equal, so you use that. I'll try to use some approximately equal symbols as we go.
Yeah, so when we're writing up our solutions, we'll try to make sure we're using the right notation. And we'll both be watching each other, trying to catch each other when we make errors.
Yeah, I'm not guaranteeing that we're going to get full marks for this exam, by the way, this sample exam. It's going to be a tough one, and maybe there will be people who get full marks, but it's not easy. And if you have any questions, of course, post them so we can sort of clarify things. Yeah. Should we get started, or have we got anything more to do?
Thinking one or two more things about presentation. I would say, don't start with an equation when you're answering a question. Start with a sentence. If you're starting with a sentence, you're probably starting a question well. And also end with a sentence. There's pretty much all the questions should have some sort of conclusion. So do write a sentence.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I forgot about that. And also, as you're going, explain the steps that you do. The marker shouldn't have to be a mind reader. It's supposed to be you're telling them, you know, what you're doing along the way. Write those in sentences too. And don't put bits of working on one side over here, another bit down here. It's not supposed to be a nice flow, a bit like the assignment that you did here.
Yes.
Actually, I've got my UNSW approved calculator, which I might need, although I have already done my rough working.
Mm-hmm.
So we probably won't stop to punch things into the calculator, but make sure you've got your calculator approved. Okay, anything more?
Can't think of anything right now. Maybe we'll think of things as the live stream goes on.
Yeah.
So Jonathan was going to start with question one. You might not be able to read this with the compression for the live stream, so please have it. If you're watching this after the fact, please have this printed out so you can see what questions we're working on, and you can access the PDF on Moodle immediately. So you want to take it away?
Yep, sure. So Okay, so I've got my rough working booklet, and I'm just going to start on this question. Okay, I can probably... I'll start down here. So, no, I'll start up here. Okay, so this question is about some temperatures that are measured at various times and decay over time. We've got to fit a line of best fit to that. And so the first thing it asks us to do is to convert the data we see in the question to some sort of different format, and so we'll do that. So, okay, so I'll just starting with a sentence. Okay, so this is question 1A. It's a good idea to make sure that it's pretty clear which question you're doing, what sort of mark on those. Okay, so converting the temperature's T, and T has been defined in the question, so I don't probably need to say too much about it. If you had a question where the variable used wasn't already actually explained in the question, then you should say what that was. Okay, so using the converting temperatures T, and these are in degrees C, as given in the question. Okay, it's a good idea to say where things are coming from as you go. Of course, some things might be ones that you've calculated before, and you could refer to that, or it could be coming from the question. Converting the temperatures given in the question to a different format here, R is ln T minus 21, gives, and I'm going to say this is to 2, I'm going to put dp for decimal places, I think that's a reasonable abbreviation, to 2 decimal places, here's my table. So this is T I'll just copy this out from my rough working. Okay. So that was part A. So we've been asked to calculate the values to 2 decimal places. Now for part B, we want to find the least squares line of best fit to this data. Okay, so to find the least squares line of best fit. Now, having read a little bit ahead, I've noticed that there's some calculations done in Maple, and we want to use those, so it's a good idea to figure out what those are, because they might save you some working. We haven't written down enough to see what that is, but I'll mention that when I get there. So we want to calculate, to find the least squares line of best fit. This line is R equals MT plus B. We define X, this is a matrix, like so, and Y, which is just a matrix with a column of the data, there we go. So we've defined those, and we want to solve to find M and B. We're going to solve a matrix equation, which is X transpose X times the vector M, or the column matrix MB, equals XT times Y. Okay, now having written this down, we might now notice that the information given in the Maple in the question is actually this calculation here of the transpose of X times Y. So we've already got that. We've already got that information, so I'll just make a note of that. The Maple output shows that X transpose Y is equal to 4.87 4.68. And I'll just note that's to 2. I just rubbed a little bit out there. Of course, in the exam, you're writing in pen. Just cross things out neatly as you go. I know you're not doing it on a computer, so you can't cut stuff out neatly. That's okay. We understand that. And then we want to solve. The equation, we're going to need this x transpose x. So I think I've got room at the bottom here to put that in. In your working in the exam, you've got a whole booklet. Don't squash things up and just try to squeeze stuff as small as possible. So this is a transpose of x times by x. And this should be easy to calculate. I've done that in my rough working. Okay. And there's lots of places where you can check that things are going okay. Of course, this must be a symmetric matrix. You should know that. You shouldn't make mistakes like where it's not a symmetric matrix. You should have plenty of time in the exam. Okay, so we now want to solve that. So, do that up here, turn to a new page, a narrower page here. So to solve, we need the inverse. So x transpose x inverse, and for a 2x2 matrix, there's a formula that you should know, and you can do that very quickly. It's just the 1 over the determinant of that, which is 14 times 4 minus 6 times 6, which turns out to be 20, so it's 1 over 20. And then you switch around these elements and put a minus sign in front of those two. So 14 minus 6 minus 6. So that's the inverse. So MB is equal to this inverse times by, where's the equation here? So MB is the inverse of that, so that's on this side here, times by that, which we worked out to be, or Maple worked out to be 4.68, and we can just multiply that out. That's minus 0.43, 1.815, and I'll just round this again to two decimal places, so to 2 dp mb, sorry, where's the eraser?
Right next to you.
So I want the least squares line of best fit. Now I'm going to write this equals because I said I don't like people writing equals, but I don't mind if you write equals and then you say it's equal to a certain number of decimal places. Okay. Oh, I already put that in there, so I'll worry about that again. So to two decimal places, this is the line, least squares line of best fit. Okay, so now we're on to part C. And for part C, what are we supposed to do? So, that's not up there. Where's part C? Right, okay, so for part C, we're going to use this line of best fit to estimate the time when the body temperature was 37 degrees. 37 degrees sounds significant, doesn't it? So that's probably when they died. Here, this as a relationship between the time and R, of course, is related to the temperature T. So hopefully we can work that out. So what we need to do is just essentially solve an equation to find T when T, little t when capital T is 37. So if T equals 37, then R equals the log of 37 minus 21. And so that is approximately 2.77. That's two decimal places. And we want to find the value of little t. And we need to solve essentially when, so R 2.77 is equal to minus 4.3 t plus 1.82. And rearranging that, t is 2.77 minus 1.82 divided by minus 0.43. Which is approximately minus 2.21. Okay. And so in other words, about 2.2 hours before so the temperature was 37 degrees about 2.2 hours before the body was found. Okay, so that's C. Now we've got to do D. Maybe I'll come up here and do D. Okay, when you're working in your exam, you know, don't jump around like this. Keep hitting on straight along in the book. So I'll put it down here. Okay, so D. We're asked to. What does D ask us to do? We want to rewrite the equation, least squares line of best fit, essentially in exponential form. So it's just a matter of rearranging things. So we are given R equals ln T minus 21, and R with our line of least squares best fit ln t minus 21 is approximately minus 0.43 t plus 1.82. okay, so this tells us that T minus 21, maybe I'll just stick to equals. T minus 21 is E to the power minus 0.43 t plus 1.82. Okay, and so t is equal to, so this is, how am I going to split this up? This is e to the minus 0.43 t times by e to the 1.82. So I'm going to work out t to the 1.82. In fact, I did that before. That's 6.17. e to the minus 0.43 t plus 21. And this, of course, here is also an approximation. It's not exactly that. So I'll just put in here, again, to two decimal places. I've made my approximation. But this is the form that was asked for in the question. And the last little bit is asking us what happens as sort of time goes to infinity, if you like. The body is not if the body has not been found, what does your equation in D predict about the limiting value of the temperature? So what does this say happens to T as capital T as little t goes to infinity, essentially? So do we use this kind of notation in Math 1031?
I think so.
Is that all right?
You can just write it in words as well.
Yeah, just write it in words. So so maybe as t goes to infinity, I think I'm going to write it like this. E to the minus 0.43 t goes to zero, so capital T goes to, well, that bit disappears, just goes to 21. I think I'd be happy with that. You can just write out a few more words. So you could say, so the equation in D predicts the body's temperature approaches 21 degrees C. Okay, I think I'm done. Okay. How do you think I went?
Yeah, I think it's very well written, so it does explain exactly what's going on. Anyone who's looking at this should be able to follow it. I think in terms of mathematical notation, there are a few symbols here which could be replaced with words. For example, this arrow here, this is...
Implies.
So I try to think of it as it follows from this, that. That's what implies means. So if you are going to use this symbol to mean implies, make sure you're using it correctly. Otherwise, just write this in words. So you could just put the word implies here. Same thing with this sort of notation. This is a mathematical notation. You could also write this in words, that as t approaches infinity, this term approaches zero. So this is a nice shorthand to use, but make sure you're using these shorthands correctly. The calculations are all done well. I can't see any reason that this wouldn't get full marks.
Okay, good. We're going to move on. Yes.
Time.
No time to rest on our laurels. Okay, so you can turn it off. Fruit salad one, isn't it?
Yes. Right, so that was actually a 7-mark question that Jonathan went through, so that was the longest question, I think, time-wise. This is a 5-mark question, so that's 5 out of the 15 for the first question block. If you want a rough metric for how long these questions should take, since it's, I guess, 1 hour for, say, question one, and there's 15 marks, that's 4 minutes per mark. So 5 times 4, I guess it gives us 20 minutes to do this question. So the previous question was 28 minutes. Right. Seems dry. So there are a lot of words in a lot of these questions. These questions will be quite wordy. And here we have Kenny. He's going to mix a fruit salad. So we're given the weight of an apple, the weight of a banana, and the weight of a strawberry. and he wants to make a salad which is exactly 9.6 kilograms or 9,600 grams. And his recipe is just, well, the recipe says just make sure you use three times the number of apples and bananas than you do strawberries. And it actually has been quite helpful to us. It's given us some notation to use. So X will be the number of apples, Y the number of bananas, and Z the number of strawberries. So the first part, part A, so I'm going to be answering question, this is 2, part A. We want to write down two equations in these variables that correspond to the recipe above. So the recipe here is that you must use this much fruit, the 9,600 grams, and this relation between the number of apples and bananas. So since they've given us the notation, I might just remark on that. So using the notation given, the total weight of fruit can be expressed by the equation. Alright, so one that the total weight of fruit is this number here. So the weight from the apples will have 120 grams per apple times the number of apples. So this is the total weight of the apples used, plus 216 grams per banana times the number of bananas used, and 24 grams per the strawberries times the number of strawberries used, and in total that should add up to the 9600. And I might just add in grams to be clear what the units are. So that's for the weight, but we also have this other condition that the total number of apples and bananas is three times the number of strawberries. So the recommendation from the recipe can be expressed as so what does it say? It says that if you look at the total number of apples and bananas, so this is the total number of apples and bananas, it should be three times the number of strawberries. Now, I don't really like to see linear equations written this way, so I'm going to rewrite this. We've written as x plus y minus 3 times z is equal to 0. So that's part A. These are the two this is a recommendation from the recipe, and that is the amount of fruit that Kenny wants to use. Okay. I've written quite big, so I will have to move to a new area. I might start question B over here and then knock this out. So for question B, we have to solve this system of equations, so these two equations together, and find all possible solutions. So for part B, well, we have two linear equations, and I think the easiest way to attack this is actually to use the technique of an augmented matrix. So in an augmented matrix, maybe I'll say as an augmented matrix, these equations are, now it's really up to me to choose the order of the equations I want to write down. I can see that I really like this one to be in the first row of my augmented matrix, so it does have a coefficient of 1 in front of the x. So I'm going to write that equation down first. So it's 1, 1, minus 3, and that totals up to 0. And the second equation is 120, 216.24, and that totals up to 9,600. And I will need to grab my rough working. That is some actual work. So the rest, this up to this point, I was actually just working from information in the question. Now I need to do some calculations. So before I rub this out, any comments on this?
No, that looks good.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that looks good. Yep. Yeah.
All right. Now, typically I would have given myself some room to actually get this thing down, get this following calculation down fully. So I would like this at the top of the page. And then I would like to show the row reductions. Since I am sort of moving to a new page, I will write out the row reduction as a sentence. So I'm going to take row 2 and make it row 2 minus 120 row 1. So what does that give me? Well, my augmented matrix is now 1, 1, minus 3, 0. I didn't change the first row, and the second one is 0, 96, 384. 9,600. So that number didn't change, these two have. And as you might suspect when you do the calculations, I plugged this into a calculator and divided it by 96. It actually turned out to be an integer, which is very helpful. So I'll now take row 2 to 1 over 96, row 2, so these are going to be my equations. It's 1, 1, minus 3, 0, 0, 1, 4, 100. And I'm in a fairly good position to back substitute now. So back substituting, I'm going to choose, this is my non-leading column here, so these two are leading. I'm going to make this one my parameter. So I'm going to let z equal t be my parameter. That'll be our parameter, the royal we, this is. So I've chosen z to be a parameter. I can now solve for y in terms of this parameter. So depending on how quick you want to do this, this one's very simple. So I'm just going to immediately write down y is 100 minus 4t. And, well, what does this equation tell me about x? Well, x will be, let's see, it'll be 3z minus y. There's a bit of work in this, so I'm being very explicit here, which is 3t minus 100 minus 4t, which is 7t minus 100. Now, I've gotten my answer to the question, but I wouldn't stop there. I did say that you should try and, when you're doing questions, try and have a nice concluding statement at the end. So make it explicit what the final solution is here. You could put it in vector form, which which might be helpful. But I think I'll just list it out so it's easy to read. The general solution is given by, well, it's given by x equals 7t minus 100, y is equal 100 minus 4t, and z is equal to t.
And I think I would be happy with that for this part. So, Jonathan, what do you think of this
just
solution?
Just answering a question on the chat. So you've solved using the augmented matrix and you get a solution that's nicely written out there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you're ready to go on to the... It's answered this part of the question, hasn't it?
Yes, it's... So this is a...
You could also say that T is a real number. Sometimes people mention that this parameter T is all real numbers. But of course, we're talking about numbers of fruit here.
Yes, I'm...
So somewhere here, we haven't really made it clear that we're talking about. We're actually going to be thinking of T as a whole number, but at the moment, this abstract solution is really valid for all fractional...
Well,
pieces of fruit, is it?
It is possible to have half a strawberry.
Half
a
strawberry, yeah, not very much. I'd be happy with half an apple, but half a strawberry, yes.
Yes.
I don't know whether you would have done that in this earlier in the course, but sometimes state here that T is a real number. I don't know.
Yeah, I think we would. So maybe I'll add that to make the solution a bit more complete. This is for.
Or real T, or some real T?
Yeah. Well, I might say for some T. Some real number T.
Yeah.
So our solution will be of this form. In fact, it's going to be a bit... If I want whole fruit, it will be a bit more restrictive than that. I would require T to also be an integer. That is actually probably going to turn up when I answer this last part. So I have my general solution here. And we're given one more condition, so that to make the salad look more appetizing, Kenny decides to use as many strawberries as possible. And the question is, what is the largest number of strawberries he could use while still following this recipe? So I'm going to rub out part B except for the general solution.
Up the top.
Oh, yes, I guess. So we have our general solution, and we want to work out how we could maximize the amount of strawberries being used. Now, as you can kind of look at this and see that, well, we can't just keep choosing more and more strawberries because this number here, y, will start dropping. So eventually we're going to be using negative bananas, which is just nonsensical. So, part C. The only restriction I would put on our solution is that, well, in this case, I would take x, y, and z. Non-negative, so in this case they can be zero or greater whole numbers. So the mathematical word for a whole number is an integer. Integers, plural. So what does that actually mean? Well, let's just concentrate on this non-negative part. So the non-negativity means Well, I'll write out all four. So I really want that 70 minus 100 is greater than or equal to 0. I would also like that 100 minus 40 is greater than or equal to 0. And I would also like that t is greater than or equal to 0. It's just saying I should use 0 or more apples, 0 or more bananas, and 0 or more strawberries. So, well, we can easily manipulate these inequalities, but we do have to be careful. Well, the first one I can easily rewrite. So if I bring this 100 onto the other side, I need 70 is greater than 100, which really gives me that t should be greater than or equal to 100 over 7, which is approximately 14.28. Let's just say 14.3. This next one you have to be careful about. I guess the easiest way I can think of doing it without having to divide by a negative number is just to add 4t to both sides. I get 4t has to be less than or equal to 100. So t is less than or equal to 100 over 4. And the last one is just the same as before. Clean these up. So these are implying that, well, okay, t is greater than or equal to, say 14.3, and t is less than or equal to 25. So these are the restrictions I'm getting. Now, I guess before I continue, I might ask a question. Do you think this is clear enough for somebody who was marking what happened here?
Yeah, I think so. Because you can say, actually, I would put a little error here. These.
Yes.
Probably forgive that in the exam. But these can be manipulated. So you're saying that these here follow from this, and I think that's a pretty straightforward consequence.
Yeah.
So that's fine, yeah.
So you just need to make sure you do get this right. It's very, if I moved, yeah, it's very easy to make a mistake here and get the inequality the wrong way around. So I wanted to divide by a positive number because I know that doesn't change inequalities. So we have this. So my strawberries must be pretty much 15 or more, or less than 25. So the maximum we can choose is this 25. So the maximum possible strawberries allowed by the recipe is 25. Now the question only asks for that is the largest number of strawberries. I feel like I do want to write out just what the consequence of this choice is. Although, strictly speaking, that's not what the question asked. So in this case, just because I want to have the question being complete, I will write out the conclusion. So in this case, the recipe is, well, if you plug it into your general solution, you'll get 7 times 25 minus 100. So I work that out to be 75 apples. Zero bananas. And, well, 25 strawberries. Actually, I just realized there is a good reason to actually checking this. I should double check that these two numbers are also integers. I've only guaranteed that t is an integer with this choice. The form of the equation actually will, in this case, guarantee the rest were integers too. So it's good to double check that you actually have gotten integer solutions as we need.
Not just integers too, but in fact positive numbers.
Non-negative.
Well, yeah, non-negative, that's right, sorry.
Zero banana is, that's a valid recipe. It's not a very good recipe, but it's a valid recipe.
And there's a lot of apples for each strawberry, so I don't know whether we trust Kenny to make our fruit salads, but...
No.
But this actually doing another little step here is a good way to check that perhaps something hasn't gone wrong. I mean, lots of questions, you know, you get to the final line, your answer, but you know, you might have made a mistake. And little checks like this at the end that seems you know, reasonable, that nothing totally crazy has gone wrong, like you've got a negative number of pieces of fruit or something like that, is a good idea. You can do that in your rough working, of course, or you can add it on the end just so that the marker knows that you're really doing your job.
Mm-hmm.
But no, I think it's all good.
Okay. Move on to.
Yeah, I don't think I need to comment on that. We'll just move on to part three. So where are the pens? I'll use black.
I'll let it dry a little bit before you start writing.
Yep. Okay, so in this question, we have a frog jumping between lily pads, and there's a certain probability of it moving from one lily pad to another. You probably should recognize this straight away as a Markov process, and we have a transition matrix. Well, of course, the question even says that it contains those words. But okay, so the first part of the question actually asks us just to write down the transition matrix T. So you could just jump straight in and write it down if you can. I find that a bit of hard work. I'd probably draw a little picture to help, and actually it's a good thing to do in the solution if you're writing out a nice solution, because it really helps the person reading it to understand what's going on. So I might just start with that. So this is part A, and I'll say a visual representation of the probabilities given in the question is the following. So I'm going to maybe draw four lily pads. Well, so here, lily pad. They've been labelled A, B, C, and D. Okay, and a frog jumps from one to the other, and we need to look at the question here, and it says that when a frog is at A, it can only jump to B. So let's put that on here. So if it's at A, it goes to B with probability 1. That's all it can do. While it is at B, the probability it jumps to A is a third. I might put that down here. No reason it has to go underneath, I'm just because I've already got an arrow on the top. And the probability while at B, the probability it jumped to A is a third, the probability it jumped to C is two thirds. So that's like so. While at C, the probability it will jump to B is two thirds. And the probability it jumped to D is one third. And I missed a bit of information here. I can see that on my picture. There's nothing about D. I missed when it is at D, it can only jump to C. So that's probability 1. Okay.
It's probably a good idea at this stage to check that on any lily pad, something must happen. And by that I mean that the total probability is 1 of leaving or staying. We haven't got any cases here where there's a probability that just stays in the lily pad. That would be possible. In that case, I might draw a little circle that just goes around from A to A. But there isn't anything like that here. From A, all the arrows leaving it have a sum of 1. There's only one arrow. From B, we've got a third that way and 2/3 that way, so the total sum of probabilities is 1 leaving B. Leaving C, we've got 2/3 and 1/3, and leaving D, we've got 1. So all of those add up to 1. So now we're in a position to write down the transition matrix, which is part A. So I'll just... So the transition matrix for this process is, and I'll call it, it's called T in the question, is it? Yes, T. And it's a good idea to label the rows and columns of your matrix in a transmission matrix. Strictly speaking, the transition matrix is just the matrix with the numbers in, but it doesn't hurt to also label the rows and columns just to help keep things in order. So the columns are going to be labeled A, B, C, and D, and the column represents where it's coming from, and the rows are going to be A, B, C, and D, representing where it's going to. Okay, so this is a 4x4 matrix, and going down each column is where it's going from in a particular initial state. So going from A, tells you where it's got everything in this column is where it's coming from A and going to somewhere else. So from A to A is 0, from A to B is 1, from A to C is 0, A to D is 0. From B, that's here, we're going 2/3 to C and 1/3 to A. So 1/3 there. There's no chance of staying at B. 2/3 of a chance of going to C, no chance of going to D. If you're on C, the frog is on C, maybe you're the frog. From C to A, there's no chance. From C to B, there's a 2/3 probability. From C to C, it doesn't happen. From C to D is 1/3. Notice these columns must be adding up to 1 each time. I'm checking that. That's 1, that sums to 1, that sums to 1. From D, there's no chance of going to A, no chance of going to B, no chance of going to C, and a probability 1. Sorry. Probability 1 going to C, no chance of staying at D. Right. Okay, so there's the transition matrix that was asked for in part A. Okay, maybe I'll just go over to here for part B. So part B is saying that if the frog starts at B, what is the probability it will return to B after 4 jumps? And we're given T to the 4th. Now, it is actually possible just to read the answer straight off this. And if you were to do that, you would need to explain how you got that. So I think it's certainly good to do a little bit more and say where you got that from. Don't just pull a number out of the air and write down the number. If I were to just write down the answer here, what would you give me, Josh? Good. Was anything that was good?
Poor presentation.
Poor presentation. You probably get the answer right, but poor presentation. Yeah. Thank you. All right. So to find the probability. Okay. So I'm gonna write out a nice long sentence. To find the probability after 4 jumps, starting at B, we calculate T to the 4, 0, 1, 0, 0. So this is the state vector saying that there's a
probably one that we're at B. So if we're actually at B, we know we're at B, it's probably one and probably zero for everything else. And I think I'll just write down the answer because t to the 4 is given in the question, but I'll make a note of that. So here's t to the 4 given in the question. If you probably can't read that on the screen, but if you've got the printout of the sample exam, you can see this is t to the 4. And this matrix multiplication, you might like to write it out in full if you're not really good at doing it in your head, but of course what this does is it picks out the second column of t to the 4, so I'm just going to write that down. And I'll put in here brackets t to the 4 is given in the question. Or maybe it would be nicer to say using t to the 4 as given in the question. Okay, so the probability then of ending up at B is given by this number here in the B position. Okay, so the probability that the frog, that a frog, starting at lily pad B returns to lily pad B after 4 jumps is 61 on 81, and that's approximately 75%. Okay, I think I'm done.
So yeah, it's only a 3-mark question.
Yeah, so I probably took a long time to do this for 3 marks.
Yeah. You only ended up using 2 parts of the board, so didn't use too much. I do like this picture.
Actually, I copied that from Josh's solution, so that's why
that's why I liked it, yes. this is actually probably helpful for yourself when you're entering this question to maybe be able to see this. You strictly don't need it. You could go straight to the transition matrix and save yourself a little bit of time.
Yeah, but it does help someone else reading the question too. If you think the most important thing perhaps is being able to communicate your ideas to someone else, and this really does help with that too. So you know, it's a good practice to get into.
Yeah, and I would want this. I would want some sort of thing about how you're calculating this probability. Doing this calculation is fairly simple, so I think anyone would be happy to just see that.
You might, of course, if it's perfectly good here to write out the whole matrix and 0, 1, 0, 0, and, you know, write it out, that's a very good thing too. And if it helps you to do it, that's an even better thing. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep, so I think that's fine.
Good. We'll move on.
Okay. I think we're moving on to question 2. So at this stage, we will be starting a new booklet. I won't be replacing the whiteboard. So we have a differential equation to solve. This is, there's a bit of setup surrounding this question. So you can see it's about that gorilla who was shot, Harambe. So it says here that 6 months after the 2016 federal election, the deceased gorilla received 11,000 write-in votes for president. So we're given an assumption that assumed the number of votes measured in units of 1,000 intended for Harambe is modeled by this first order linear differential equation. where t is the time in months after the shooting, by solving the differential equation and applying the initial condition, so you have to make sure you read the text to work out what this initial condition is, determine the number of votes Harambe would have received if the election were held 2 months after the shooting at time t equals 2. Okay. So let's just start. So the first thing to note is that this is actually a mistake, and I just realized. So I'll have to read that later.
Mistakes in your rough working are fine, as long as you correct them when you get to the...
Yes. Two mistakes now, actually. I just realized one thing. So I will be redoing some of these calculations now. So firstly, I might just note that this is a linear first order. I like to use the abbreviation D for differential equation. And what we need to solve these differential equations, well, a good technique is the integrating factor. So with integrating factor, so the integrating factor here, well, it's going to be the exponential of the integral of this center term here. So it's plus that. R of x equals the exponential of the integral of 1 over 1 plus t dt. And this is the exponential of the log of 1 plus t. And that can be simplified to just 1 plus t. Okay, so we have our integrating factor. Now, when solving these sorts of problems, really, I think the technique we've been teaching you is to use the equation that you get, that you can write down now, a solution in terms of a certain integral of the terms in the equation, certain things involving this. And I would actually try and write this out as explicitly as possible, just for yourself, so you know you're not making mistakes. So using the integrating factor method, well, we can get that the number of votes at time t is equal to 1 over r of t, the integral of r of t, and times by this term here. I never gave this term a name, so I will just write it out as I see it. Now, I did have a lot of students asking me a surprising number of times whether these two could be cancelled out, and no, they can't. There's no way to move a function of t inside an integral. There's a very hard barrier there. I mean, and if you think about it, if I could cancel that out, I would teach you that, because that's much simpler. So no, this has to be on the outside. So here, this is, well, that's 1 over 1 plus t. And nicely, this 1 plus t and that 1 plus t cancel out to give me just 2t dt. And this is fairly easy to integrate. 2t integrates t squared, so you get 1 over 1 plus t. And just remember, when we're doing this integral, there is a constant of integration, and it appears here. So this is the general solution to this differential equation, on the paper. So we can use this to solve our particular case. In our particular case, we have a certain initial condition we want to solve. So what is our initial condition? Same. Now here's where I made a mistake when I was first reading the question. You can see that at 6 months later, the group got relieved 11 thousand votes. You have to remember that n is measured in thousands of votes. So the initial condition is n equals 11, meaning 11,000 votes, at t equals 6. Time was measured in months. Let's double check that. T is time in months, and n is number of votes, but measured in units of 1,000. So we have our initial condition written out nicely. So I think it's good to actually state what this is so you know you're not making a mistake. And we can now use it to match this up. So plugging into plugging this into our solution, our general solution gives. So what do we need? I'm going to need that 11, the number of votes in thousands, is equal to 1 over 7 times 36 plus C. So we can rearrange that to get that C is equal to 77 minus 36. So if you're not good with subtraction, because, well, frankly, sometimes I'm not, you may want to use a calculator for this. In this case, it is 41. So C is 41. So we've matched up our initial condition, which means we can use it in our solution. And now we can finally answer the question that we were asked at the end. What would happen if the election were held 2 months after the shooting? So how many votes would he have gotten at that stage? So the question is saying, what is happening at t equals 2? At t equals 2, well, we have our solution, let's just plug it in. N would be equal to 1 over 3 times 4. So this is t squared, so plus 41. Actually, I'm not happy with just leaving it there. I think I should write that out explicitly. So the particular solution here is that n of t, the one that matches our initial condition, is 1 over 1 plus t times t squared plus 41. That just makes it a bit more sensible, I think, to do this. So at t equals 2, n is equal to this, which is 44 over 3. Not so good with division. So according to this, I get approximately 14.7 to the decimal places. So now I can draw my conclusion. So if we were to hold the the election were held 2 months after the shooting, we'd expect about, well, I've made quite an approximation here, so this is only an approximate answer. So I'll say about 14,700 votes. Okay. Any comments about that? So you think I maybe should use?
Yeah, that's good. I'd put DP rather than PD.
Ah, yes. Sorry. It's two professional equipments.
That seems right.
Yeah, so this exam is marked by a human, so numbers like this, I think a human would be happy with. The computer sometimes is a little bit more finicky, but it will be a human marking this, so you will be talking to a human, we will be understanding. Anything else?
No, I think that's all good. It's just important. I think it's just important to make sure that you get this process correct. And one common error that students make is to do this sort of integration. And you're used to it when they're doing an integral. You know, it's, you work out stuff and then you put plus c afterwards. Whereas this plus c isn't just, you know, this stuff and then plus c later. It's built in inside the expression here. So this is. Don't be worried about that. I know it does throw a few people when they first sort of see these techniques, but this, all good, I'd say. Let's move on. Is there another dot?
Yes.
Okay. Where's my black pen gone? So this is now part two. Get rid of this new book. So we're not sticking to the same book, was it? This is just all part of question two. What have I done with my notes? Yeah. Okay, so I've got my rough work. Yeah, that's good. All right, so this is quite a short question. I'd say this one's probably a little bit on the easy side for this exam, but we'll do it anyway. And we're just told some information about how the volume of blood passing through an artery of radius R, you know, how these quantities are related, and it's just given in this equation. So, and we want to find the rate of change of the volume V, given some information about the radius and the rate of change of the radius. Okay, so we are given, just remember starting with a sentence, we are given that V equals KR to the fourth, where K is some constant. There's nothing in this question actually that's going to tell us what K is. It just carries on throughout the question. I might just make a note of the fact that where V is the volume in litres. I mean, this is mentioned in the question, so this is not so important. V is the volume in litres and R is the radius in millimetres. Okay, so from here we need to use the chain rule because both V and R depend on T and we want to find dV by dT. We want to find, so I guess that's something you need to interpret from the question. Find the rate of change of V in terms of K, so the rate of change is dV by dt. And of course on the right hand side here, R is a function of T, but it's not just R there, it's some function of R, R to the 4, so we need the chain rule. So using the chain rule, dV by dt is, K is just a constant, 4R cubed dr by dt. So the chain rule says that if we're differentiating some function of r, it's the derivative of that function with respect to r times the derivative of r with respect to t. And r to the fourth differentiates to 4r cubed, and then times by dr by dt. Okay, and so from the question, we're told R is 5 millimetres. We're interested in what's happening when R is 5 millimetres. So when R is 5 millimetres, and dr by dt is 2 millimetres per second, we find, and we just work it all out. dv by dt is k times 4, r cubed is 5 cubed, and dr by dt is 2. And I'll just say this is in litres per second. I think we don't really have to worry too much about the units in this question. K has got some units in it, and we're told, V is in litres and time is in seconds, etc. And so this is just 1,000 K litres per second. But I think that's the end of the story.
Yes.
I think that's enough. I could finish with a sentence that says the rate of change of volume V. Should I do that?
Find that.
Yeah, I think here it's such a short, easy little thing. I haven't anywhere said the rate of change of V is dV by dt. Might be worth mentioning. I'll do it. So maybe I wouldn't have needed, perhaps I should have probably said the rate of change of V is dV by dt, just to indicate that's what this quantity is, because the question does ask for the rate of change of V, and I haven't actually until now mentioned what the rate of change of V is and related it to this. Okay, so it'd be a good idea either have stated that dV by the rate of change of V is dV by dt, or put this conclusion at the end that spells that out explicitly. Okay, all good? Next question is on the other side of that.
Thanks.
Shall we
turn
it over?
This is fine.
Give myself. This is a bit of a long question, so I will give myself time to work. I have my rough working here. And someone just pointed out in the chat the answer to part one was actually slightly wrong. When I added 41 and 4, I got 44, which would be, of course, 45. And 45 over 3 is just 15. So I lost a mark there.
Good to see people are paying attention.
So this question actually gives us a system of differential equations. So it says here that the, and again they've given us notation, well I really need to for this question, that x is the number of male lovebirds and y is the number of female lovebirds. And it says that currently they have 0 male lovebirds and 1,000 female lovebirds. So x and y are just these absolute numbers, number of lovebirds, and t is time in years. So firstly, by considering these different firstly it asks us to do a little bit of interpretation. So look at this and explain why it's clear that the female population of lovebirds will be decreasing. So there's not really any calculations that need to be done for this one. It's fairly clear from the equations. This is 3 part A. Well, if you do look at the equation, you can see it really has two terms in it, and both of these terms you can guarantee to be negative. So we just need to make that argument. So firstly, since the number of lovebirds relay, I mean male or female. Is a positive quantity.
Negative.
Actually, switch this. Thanks. That's better. Well, that's just telling us that the variables x and y are both greater than or equal to 0. But since they're both greater than or equal to 0, well, that means minus x would be less than or equal to 0, and minus 3y would be less than or equal to 0. So the rate of change of female lovebirds is, well, it's given by the equation that dy dt is minus x minus 3y, and both of these terms are guaranteed to be negative. So this and this are negative, so those, their sum is also negative. Hence, the number of female lovebirds is decreasing. You don't really need to know anything about the system rather than that these are positive quantities. Okay. So that first part's fairly easy. The next part's actually going to be the hard part. Is we're actually going to solve this differential equation, the system of differential equations, and apply the initial conditions. And this is the part that took me the longest. And once you have your solution, part C, the last part should be easy to answer. So nothing I wrote there is actually essential for the next part. It does help us interpret what's going on, but it won't affect my solution. So when we're faced with a system of differential equations like this, the technique we usually apply is to solve out one of the variables and turn it into a second order system. To make it easiest, I would recommend solving for x. So solving the second equation given, so the one in the question, for x gives, well, x is going to be equal to minus the rate of change of y minus 3 times y. And maybe to make my life a little bit easier, I'm going to actually rewrite this in the dash notation for the derivative. Because a dash is much easier to write out than dy dx so many times. So now that we have x purely in terms of y, I can use that in the first equation to get a second order equation for y. So I just plug this. So plugging this into the first equation given, the first equation gives. So we're going to end up with, and here's where the dash notation I think is helpful, I end up with the derivative of x, which is minus y, minus the derivative of y, 3 times y, take the derivative of that, should be equal to minus, no. So it should be equal to 5 times x, which in this case is minus y dash, minus 3y, plus 12 times y, So that implies, let's just clean up this right-hand side. If you are doing this calculation for the first time, I recommend doing it as slow as necessary to get it right. I might just clean this up. It is minus 5 prime minus 3y. And I'm going to move all the terms onto this side. I want to move this term because I like a positive sign in front of my second derivative. If I move y double prime over, I get second derivative of y. Now let's be careful. I'm going to add on 3 lots of the first derivative, excuse me, minus twice first derivative. And I'm left over with minus 3 times y. So we've gotten a second order differential equation for y. I might just do some work over here so I don't rub everything out. So we've learned techniques for solving these equations. The technique is to look, this is a homogeneous constant coefficient second order equation. We just need to look at the auxiliary equation to work out what the solutions are. So the auxiliary equation for this, I might just write, make it clear, this is a second order DE, is, now we assume a solution of the form e to the lambda t, or some constant multiple of that, or e to the mt, I think is a common thing, but all you really need to know is that the second derivative becomes the m squared minus twice m, that's really equals 0. So in the interest of time, I would go straight to that. And your examiners know where these equations come from. So I think that's an okay step for me. And because they were very kind to us, this is very easy to solve. It factors the wrong way around. Yeah, minus 3 plus 1. And I can quickly double check that by expanding it out. You will find that the coefficients match. So the plus 1 and the minus 3 are minus 3. The minus 3 plus a 1 is a minus 2. So we have either m is equal to minus 1 or m is equal to 3. So before I move on, do you think they should specify where this comes from?
And I think it's all right, especially if you call it the auxiliary equation. If you didn't, I think that's fine.
Because I think it's also okay, some people do write, assuming a solution of the form required to get to this equation.
Which would be y equals e to the m t, is that right? Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think y equals maybe a constant multiple e to the mt is what we usually teach. But I'm okay. If you say auxiliary equation, I know what you're talking about. I'm happy for you to jump to that part. Right, so we have our two roots. So might as well just write out what the general solution is based on this. So hence, the general solution for y is, well, y should be equal to some constant e to the minus, I better make sure I match my rough working. This will get a bit annoying. So I went for some constant e to the 3t. So I went a e to the 3t plus b e to the minus t. And I might just specify a, b, real numbers. Okay.
Yeah, of course it would be okay if this were the other way around, a e to the minus t plus b e to the 3t, but
The only reason I'm choosing this is my rough working has it in this form, so I don't want to be translating in my brain when I'm trying to write out the solution. So if you have done rough working, yeah, don't try and redo it again. Right, so we have a solution for y, and this will allow us to find a solution for x. I might do that over here. So, well, as soon as we know y, this equation here tells me how I can find my solution for x now, and how it's linked to the solution for y. So, using our solution for y in, well, I'd like to, in this case, I want to refer back to this equation. I had this equation from earlier, so I'm going to just put a little label there and just say I'm using it in the equation which I've labeled star gives, well, it gives that x is equal to minus the derivative of y minus 3 times y calculation. So minus 3 times a e t times b e minus t so how many lots of this are there? I get a minus 3 a minus 3 I get a minus 6 a e to the 3 t plus b minus 3 b the minus 2b e to the minus t. So I have a solution for x and I have a solution for y. Now I'm going to use the initial conditions they provided to try and work out what these unknown a's and b's are. So this is a bit of a long question. It does take a while to get to the solution. Right. So firstly, it's probably wise to look at the question, write down the initial conditions so we don't make a mistake trying to translate it into what we're being told. So the initial conditions are, so it says here that currently there are a zero male lovebirds, so x is zero. There are 1,000 female lovebirds, so y is 1,000, and that occurs at t equals 0. So initially, t was measured in years from now, so 0 years from now is t equals 0. Okay. So putting this into our solution, our general solution, gives, so I'll start with x, so I'm going to get that 1, so at t equals 0, well, on one side we have minus 6a, I might just write the e to the 0, that is just 1. Minus 2b e to the 0, that's supposed to equal 0. Actually, I think maybe I wouldn't write that. I think I would just write minus 6a minus 2b. then probably isn't much work for them. Perhaps writing out the e to the zero. And the second equation we have, so we plug it, this was the equation for x, the equation for y. Yes, that's that. A plus b equals 1,000. So solutions. I guess y and x are both different parts of the solution. Right. So we want to solve these two linear equations. Now we could use an augmented matrix, but it's only two equations, two unknowns. That's probably a little bit of overkill for this situation. So I might just, in this case, I think I might just take this equation and add six copies of it to the top to find perhaps b to begin with, or maybe add two copies. So I'll call this equation 1 and equation 2, adding 2 copies of 2, so 2 times
6 copies.
Well, it depends which one I'm aiming for.
Oh, you're aiming to get rid. Okay.
I was thinking of getting B first, but now I think maybe I'll go for A first. So it's whichever one you want to aim for. I'm thinking I want to get rid of that B. So I'm going to add 2 copies of the second equation to 1 copy of the first equation. And what does that tell me? So the nice thing about these equations is you can just sort of add versions. So if I take this and add on 2A, I'm going to get a minus 4A. And the whole reason for doing this is this minus 2b now goes away, and I just get a 2,000. So minus 4a is 2,000. Hence, well, you can easily solve that one. A equals minus 500. So you know a. And I think actually the easiest thing to do here is just use this second equation now. So the second equation now tells me that if I was to, a is minus 500, so b will have to be 1,500. So using this information in equation 2 says, well, I'll do it a little slowly, it's minus 500 plus b equals 1,000, so therefore it implies that b is 1,500. And now we can actually write out the solution for the equation. So this is my conclusion for part B. Hence the solution for this initial condition is, start with x. So this is a little bit of calculation, so I have to take minus 6a, so minus 6 times minus 500 is 3,000, e to the 3t. I need minus twice b, so minus 3,000, e to the minus t. And y will be equal to, well, this one's easier because it's just a and b. I'm just using a and b directly. It's minus 500 e to the 3t plus 1,500 e to the minus t. And a quick mental check is to check it does satisfy the initial conditions. So when you put in 0, it's 3,000 minus 3,000. That is 0. When I put in 0 here, it's minus 500 plus 1,500, so that's just 1,000 or 1,000. But yeah. So there is a lot of work, I think, involved in just getting to this answer. You need to use the auxiliary method, you need to work out what x is, you need to set up, use these initial conditions. So it only said 5 marks, but I think it should probably be worth a bit more, maybe?
Yeah, possibly worth more than 5.
Alright. This is only a practice version, so the marks aren't exactly what they would be in the real version. Okay. So that's part C. So we have our conclusion.
So that's part B.
Part B, sorry. And part C is to use this model we just found to answer a question. So the question says when, it says here to the nearest day, will there be one male lovebird for each female lovebird? So some sort of balance between the genders. All right. So we have our model. And I'm just going to rub out this center section because I don't need much to answer this. So for there to be equal number of lovebirds in both genders, we need, well, obviously we need that x of t equals y of t, and in terms of this model, that's 3,000 e to the 3t minus 3,000 e to the minus t should be equal to minus 500 e to the 3t plus 1,500 e to the minus t. So you can easily rearrange that. Let's say bring all the e to the 3t's onto one side to get 2,000, sure I'm doing this right. Yep. So 2,500 e to the 3t should be equal to 4,500
e. Would that be 3,500?
Add 500 to both sides. Oh, yes. That's the ending. Right. I did add 500, didn't I? Yes, I am adding 500 to this side to give me 3,500. E to the 3t should be equal to 4,500 e to the minus t. So we can easily manipulate this. In this case, again, this is another case where I could easily make a mistake. Multiplying this by e to the t, this will raise this by 1 power of e to the t and lower this down to e to the naught. So it's e to the 4t. I'm also going to move this term onto the other side, so 4,500 divided by 3,500. If I'm ignoring the hundreds, this is 45 over 35, or 9 over 7. Okay. So, the other steps I wasn't very explicit in, I will be explicit in this one. So taking logs of both sides, end up with 4t is the log 9 over 7. Hence, t is equal to 1/4 log 9 over 7. So in years, that is approximately 0.06282, and that should be accurate enough for my purposes. It's in years. So if we work that out to be days, in this case I'm just going to multiply it by 365.
So it's not a leap year.
Yeah, there is a question about that. I could do 365.25 to be more accurate. I'm not going to worry about too much about that. So. Or about 20, well, if I round this up, it's 23 days. So at this point in the question, I think I'm happy with that conclusion. I guess I'm a bit tired of this question now, so if I was in the test, I might want to move on with something else and come back and write a concluding sentence later. But do you think I should have a concluding sentence?
Oh, it would be better, but maybe we should move on. We don't want to run out of time to complete the exam. Maybe you just leave a little bit of space to write your concluding sentence afterwards when you've got some time at the end. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. Which is the last question. Okay, so the last question. So the last question is a little bit different to the others. It's not a modelling question. It's purely theoretical, and the exam will have some sort of theoretical question in it. But most of them are sort of modelling questions with words, and you have to interpret stuff. But this is just a purely theoretical question. So. First of all, what have we got here? We've got a twice differentiable function, f of x, has the property that its graph meets the x-axis with a horizontal tangent at x equals a and x equals b. All right, so maybe we'll just write down what that information means first. I might just do it over here. So we are told... y equals f of x looks something like, we're not told anything explicit about it other than what happens at the endpoints of a, b. So I'll draw a little picture here. Maybe here's a and b. And the graph of the function has a horizontal tangent at a and b. Okay, so let's just maybe draw a picture like that. Something like that. Okay, and then what is this information telling us? So it meets the x-axis at a horizontal tangent at a and b. So so it meets the x-axis at a. At x equals a and x equals b means f of a equals 0 and f of b equals 0. And having a horizontal tangent there means that the derivative of f is also 0 there. So we've got this information to play with. Okay, so now we want to go ahead and try and calculate the average value of x squared f double dashed of x, and hopefully it'll turn out to be related to the average value of f of x. All right, so we need to know the formula for the average value, but we can just let's just start with it. So the average value of f double dashed of x over the interval AB is, maybe I'll call it I, don't really mind what I call it here, but I'll just call it something. It's 1 over the length of the interval times the area under the curve. And we're calculating the average value of f double. Oh, hang on. Oh, I made a mistake. It's the average value of x squared.
F double dashed of x. Sorry about that.
So that's the area under the curve of this function here.
Okay. So
derivative.
Yep. Good. Thank you. Okay. So we calculate the area under the curve here, and we want to, in the end, relate this to the average value of f. So we're going to have to relate to an integral of f of x. And so probably the obvious thing to do here, if you've, you know, after having learnt about integration by parts, a lot of the examples integration by parts have this kind of form, although not sort of in an abstract way with an abstract f. But let's try integration by parts. Okay, so
integrating by parts. Now, when you integrate by parts, you choose some part of this expression to differentiate and another part to integrate. And, well, I guess it's easy to integrate a derivative, and it's very easy to differentiate this x squared. And when you differentiate x squared, it becomes x, which gets a bit simpler. And if we're thinking, we're probably going to have to do this twice because we've got two derivatives here, and differentiating this x squared twice will get us down to zero. So we might have to integrate by parts twice. Let's do it once to begin with. So we're going to be using... I guess the typical notation would be, do you use this u equals x squared and dv is f double dashed of x dx, and then with u equals x squared du is 2x dx, and with v is f double dashed of x dx, v is s just f dashed of x, remove one derivative. Okay, so with that we get I equals, we've got the 1 over b minus a, and then this becomes, it's the integration by parts formula tells us this is u times v minus the integral of v du. Okay, so u times v is x squared f dashed of x at a and b minus the integral from a to b of b du. So this is going to be just 2x f dashed of x dx. Okay. All right. Now, as long as you can sort of think ahead of it here, you'll realize we're making progress, because now we're going to be evaluating this here at b and a, and we know that the derivative of f at b and a is zero. So maybe I'll write that out very explicitly. Just expand this out. So this is b squared f dashed of b minus a squared f dashed of a minus 2 times the integral from a to b of x f dashed of x dx. And of course these things here are zero because of there. So maybe I'll just do this. And I'll simplify it a little bit. So this is minus 2 over b minus a integral from a to b of x f dashed of x dx. And now I'd like to integrate by parts again, because we're making progress. We're getting closer just to the integral of f. So integrating by parts again. With this time, we're going to take u to be x, so du is dx, and we're going to take dv to be f dashed of x dx, and so v integrating that is f of x. So now our integral becomes, this average value, I, becomes minus 2 over b minus a outside of uv, that's x, f of x, from a to b, minus the integral from a to b of v du, which is just f of x dx, and that's looking promising because here we have just an integral of f of x, which is involved in the average value of f of x. So this is b f of b minus a f of a and from before we already worked with the conditions in the question tell us that f of b and f of a are zero. That was here. If you wanted to, you could label these, say, 1 and 2, and then actually say here, using 1 and using 2, where you use them. That's probably a good idea. That's 0, that's 0. And then just simplifying, that minus cancels with that one there. So this is 2 over b minus a, integral from a to b, f of x dx, which is equal to 2 times, well, the average value of f is this integral from a to b of f of x divided by b minus a. So this is just 2 times the average value of f of x over ab. Over the interval. Okay, so we've shown that the average value of x squared f double dashed of x is twice the average value of f over the interval AB. I think we're done. Yeah. Have I done here?
Yeah, I think that's very clear. I think at some point it should be. So here is, this is indicating why these are vanishing. So you could, as you said, you could label these and refer back to these conditions as why those terms are vanishing. I think there needs to be some sort of explanation, something which is showing.
Yeah, I think in hindsight, I should have given these some numbers and put after here using, well, maybe I can even do that now. Okay. 1, 2, and then here using, which one's that using?
That's 2. Using, yes.
And down here using 1. Okay.
Okay. Yep, so that. So this is a very theoretical question. If you hadn't seen this thing before, I think Milan may have done a very similar thing in his lecture stream. So this may have been very surprising.
Yeah. Okay. I think the typically the sort of harder theoretical question is probably not something you've seen in the maybe you have, but you know, often we use past exam questions. This was a past exam question.
Oh, really?
Yeah. We've used past exam questions in the lectures, so probably the tougher theoretical question this year might be one you haven't seen, but maybe not. I don't know. Okay, so we probably took about 2 hours, I think. How did it go for time? Yep,
exactly two hours.
Now, of course, in the exam, you won't be chatting and waffling on like this. Yes, all got to be quiet and just doing your own work. So hopefully, you can see that there should be. Plenty of time to work out your solution and write it out nicely in the exam. So like I said at the beginning, the number of questions in the exam is sort of less than half what it used to be. But we do really expect you to write down nice solutions that are clearly explained. Of course, you know, I'm sure everyone is wondering, you know, how much explanation do you need? Well, that's a matter of judgment, really. You need to explain enough that it's clear. But you know, don't go overboard. We don't want big long slabs of text with lots of irrelevant material. It's not about trying to pad it out. That's not what this is about. It's about actually putting in explanations that make it clear what you're doing at each step.
Yes, that can be a bit of a. It is possible to go too simple. I think in the assignment that you were doing during the session, I did see a few examples where students went a little bit too simple with their explanation, re-going over basic algebra.
Yeah.
So if it is clear how one line gets to another, you probably don't need to go through that. But I think the explanations we gave here were at that sort of level. We would
probably expect right. I think so. In fact, probably we'll make the marking scheme. We'll watch this again and then make up the marking scheme according to this.
Yes.
Roughly. Okay, so anything else to say? Or apart from good luck?
Well, obviously good luck. One student did ask, the questions are different in the exam from the ones we just did. In your mastery test, of course, these were just basic skills, so the questions weren't very different. In fact, they were the same with different numbers. You will have different questions, so just bear that in mind.
Yeah.
Okay, well, good luck. Don't forget to ask. I believe where the exam was posted on Moodle is also a forum where the students can ask questions.
Yep, so you can ask them there. Would we check this? There's no live chat after this.
There is no live. I wouldn't put any comments underneath the video. They may not get seen. So if you put them in Moodle, we both usually
we'll
will see
them. There, yeah.
If you put them in Moodle the night before the exam, we may not see them for time reasons.
Yes.
So start preparing as soon as possible.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, well, good luck.
Good luck. And thanks for your attention.
Yeah.